I'm gonna get this guy on a slip lead really quickly, and we're gonna end up introducing him to a remote. He's never been on the remote collar. So we're not using this because he needs it or anything like that, and that's something that's really important, is that this is a phenomenal tool. Soko, place down. It shouldn't be viewed as a last resort tool. So I'm just gonna kinda fix him up a little bit here, make sure that's touching. Good, we have this. We have this. And one of the main questions that we get from people is, what should a dog look like when we're introducing to place? Because sometimes you'll have people that will say, hey, they'll email us or something, you know, I tried everything, I tried this, this doesn't work, I can't get my dog to stop doing this, I bought this remote collar, and I want to kind of get started. One, you shouldn't be just randomly buying a remote collar, even if it's the right one, definitely not over the counter. And two, you shouldn't be getting this tool because nothing else is working. This is a happy-go-lucky puppy. We spent a lot of time building drive, building pizzazz, building spunk, building a dog that's having fun. So a couple of things without the remote collar that is important for you guys to see is we have a dog that can do these things first. So there's three verbal markers that we teach: good, yes, and nope. We're primarily going to be working with the good and the yes for right now. And I guess we'll go ahead and we'll just use place as an introduction and kind of go from there. So first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to get him on over here, all right? And this is already a dog that didn't come in with the most food drive and really understanding of working, but really picked it up quick. So what we're going to do is we're going to show you some stuff. I'm going to have him over here. I might down. Good. Place. Yes. We have a dog that has already figured out that when I say place, you can get a yes out of me. So on yes, the dog takes food. This is all without the remote collar, right? Place. Yes. Good job. We want a dog having fun. I'll show you a couple of these really quickly. Place. Yes. Good boy. All fun, fun, fun. Having a blast. Look at the difference in the good. Good means keep doing what you're doing. Basically, hold your position or keep doing what you're doing in your position. In this case, it's going to be a hold. Place. Nope. Yes, I'm going to hold off on that. I want to see a little bit of a sharper, a better response, a cleaner response. Oliver, sit. Good. Place. Good. That's what I want to see. Now, I can reward this not by releasing him. If I want him to stay and let him know he's kicking butt, I said, good, I'll bring food to him. So this is what we should have. When we're introducing the remote, you can use place with sits and downs if your dog knows that, or you can use recall with sits and downs. What I would avoid is mixing recall and place with the remote collar in the same session. One of the reasons for this is in one situation, the remote collar sensation means go away from me to that placemat. In another situation, the remote collar sensation can mean come to me, and that's how you relieve pressure. What we're teaching here is not do this and if you don't listen, the button's gonna come on and I'm gonna shock you into compliance. What we're teaching here essentially is replacing the leash. It's Bluetooth. We have an auxiliary wire and we're teaching a dog that already knows how to respond to leash pressure. We already have a dog that can do this basically. Come here, buddy. We have a dog that with leash pressure, I can get a sit. With leash pressure, I can also get it down, right? So we have these things. This is what I'm looking for. I can sit, get that. I can down, get that, right? And even if I'm not saying it, good. Good. Body helps a little bit. So we have a dog that knows sit. We have a dog that knows down. We have a dog that knows place, right? And it's seamless. It's not place and I'm bringing a dog there. We have a dog that's having fun with this. We also have a dog that knows the basics of recall, which is Oliver here. Good boy. Sit. This is going to give me eye contact. Yes. But I have to choose, once I find the remote collar, what I want to use. Do I want to introduce him to recall, or do I want to introduce him to place? We're going to choose place for today, okay? So, a couple things that we need. Place. Good. Down. Is we need to find his remote collar working level. So I'm gonna zoom in a little bit so you guys can see this. A response. I'm gonna shut the sound box off for this because I don't want him to get curious about the sound. So right now what we're gonna go ahead and do is I'm gonna practice on like a level one and little by little bump the level up until I see him respond. The collar is on the right side of his neck. So we're gonna wait for him to relax. If I have a dog that's super spazzy, if I have a dog that doesn't know how to relax and pay attention, I'm probably not introducing the remote because my goal is to have them as chill as possible, have almost nothing going on, so I can find the level that they respond to versus being in a really loud environment or a really hectic environment and having him maybe feeling something but ignoring. I wanna know what you feel. My levels might go higher down the road, but I wanna know that you actually feel this. What we initially find might get lower down the road, but we're gonna go ahead and we're gonna start. And what I'm waiting for is that could have been it. That was a level six. I'm gonna go down to a three, and then I'm gonna like really try. I'll wait till this kind of is done. I'll wait for him to settle. I'm going to tap, 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 tap on three. I didn't see anything. I'm gonna bump up to a four. I'm going to tap, 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 tap. I'm pretty sure he feels that. So four is likely what we're gonna work with. We might end up on a three. The average human, especially with the comfort pads that we have on this, which dissipates levels, won't start feeling it anywhere until around like an 11 to like a 21. I start to feel it around a 17 or 18. For those that are wondering what it feels like, it's a TENS unit. It's muscle contraction. So I have videos where I've maxed the level out on my neck and stuff. You guys can see that on our YouTube channel. But what we're looking for is basically for him to feel a sensation and it not necessarily do anything. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to turn this back on. And we're going to show you a little bit of how we introduce the short answer to this is we introduce the remote collar over something he's already gonna do, over something he's already kicking butt with, over something, because down the road, I want to be able to use this to help me when I need it. I wanna be able to yell. I wanna be able to speak up if he knows how to do something but is really distracted and I have no means of communication, he might be off leash. I wanna be able to give him feedback that goes, oh, sorry, I got distracted. The problem is that a lot of people are using this to just try and stop dogs and it takes on a very negative association. That's like me only using my voice or my mouth to yell at you. I never use it to converse with you. So that's what we wanna spend time doing in the beginning is teaching the language, layer it over what the dog already knows so when the timing happens to shut off, the dog figures out he's in control of that, just like leash pressure. We're replacing the leash pressure concept and we're building up, it's basically negative reinforcement that's coming on first in the sequence. We're prepping the dog for when the moment comes that I might have to use positive punishment or interrupt and the dog knows the language so if I yell, it's very clear. Versus people just turning this on and trying to stop the dog. A lot of times you can shut dogs down or make them more nervous or anxious and you don't even get results or you seemingly, it seems like you get results because you suppress the dog but the dog is really confused and sometimes you can shut down curiosity and movement in other areas. So, what did I say he was on? A four, right? So a four is what we're gonna work. And you guys will be able to sort of hear this when, let me make sure that's on. Yep, it's on. You guys are gonna be able to hear this. So the first thing that I'm gonna do is I'm gonna, yes, give him a little bit of his food. You guys will be able to pay attention to when the sound is going on. I'll let him sort of finish that up, all right? I'll have him right over here. Come on, buddy, monkey, you ready? Sit, good. Place, yes, good job, buddy, so good. Down. Yes. It's layering over what he does. It comes on first in the sequence. When he performs the command, the button shuts off. This is not correction level. This is teaching him the pattern, teaching him that he's responsible for what he feels and that he has a say in this game. It's a fun game. Please. Yes. Good boy. Good job. Very nice. It's a fun session. This is what we want to see. It kills me when I see people who are advocates of these tools and you have a dog that's being forced into this or forced into that, right? We're just trying to teach this. Down the road, if I have to say, hey man, I need you to do this whether you want to or not, because I know you want to do that, I can actually use the tool to enforce, and it's a tool that he's familiar and fluent with. There's no point in me yelling at you guys in Spanish because you weren't listening to when I was whispering to you in Spanish if you don't speak Spanish in the first place. So this is language building. This is a must for every single dog that comes through our program. Teach the dog what to do before you spend time using this tool to teach them what not to do. I have to teach this tool before I can rely on this tool to help me in other areas. All right, very important. This is for problem dogs, this is for happy-go-lucky dogs, puppies, all that stuff. This is not a last resort tool if you know what you're doing. And more importantly, this is not a, well, I can get that done without that. We already have the job done without this. It's not about needing this, but it's about having the ability to have an insurance policy, having the ability to help my dog when he's 800 yards from me, having the ability to be able to teach a dog something and transfer it to a dog owner who might not be as good of a trainer as I am to get certain results without tools. Bottom line, just because I or some of you guys might be good enough to ride a horse bareback doesn't mean that if someone comes to you for horseback riding school that you should not set them up with the saddle and the reins. It makes no sense. So this is not an ego, well, I can get this without this or this. That's not what this is about. One, I can get this without, but I will never own a dog that I won't remote collar train. I really, really doubt that. It's one of the coolest tools on the market if you know how to use it. But two, if you can teach an owner this, the button feels the same when I press it versus when an owner presses it. So this is important stuff. So we're gonna get into this and show you some more fun stuff, right? Please. Yes, good job, bud. Very nice. Please. Good. Nope. Good. You see, I'm not relying on this to just run him back. I use my hand and my body to help him. The button stayed on, then it shut off. Down. Yes. Good job. On yes, the dog comes. On good, I bring to you, right? Please. Good. Oh, very nice, buddy. So good. Super sharp. Yes. So eventually, I'll call him off of this stuff. Not now. We'll keep it simple. A dog goes, oh, this is interesting. I happen to feel a little something. And then when I do what I already know how to do, it happens to shut off. Maybe this guy's teaching me another language. I want to teach my dog Bluetooth. I want my dog to be free. I don't want to have to walk around on a leash forever when I go to off-leash areas or I go hiking. I want my dog to be free, practice making decisions on their own, get to a point where I might not need to use this, but I can use it and it can help them if my dog needs help. I always want to be in a position to help my dog. The concept of like, when will I not need to use the remote or this, you're going to get to a point where you don't need it, but I want you to think about what that's like. That's like saying you're using a language to help communicate to your dog, and once your dog gets good at that language, the question becomes, well, when can I stop speaking to my dog and just have him do it? It's like, why would you deprive your dog of a language that's helping them? You want to help to build habits and build good choices so a dog does things on their own, but to think that you're going to get to a point where you never have to communicate to your dog, that seems a little bit silly. I'm always going to want to communicate to my child, to my kid, to my pet, to help them, guide them through this life where we're going to encounter a lot of really confusing and weird situations. If I have multiple different languages, my body, my words, my leash, how my hands were taught when I started food luring, remote collar, my dog is multilingual, not just bilingual, multilingual, and I can help my dog through any situation. But if you're trying to change the oil in your car and you don't know how to do it, and I find the directions, but the directions are in Spanish, me reading the directions in Spanish is not going to help you with this problem. This is the issue that a lot of people are having, even people or trainers that are advocates for these tools, is they're trying to use a language to help with the problem, but the language is not known. So what I have to do is remove you from the problem, forget changing the oil. Let me get you fluent in Spanish. Then, when the time comes, when I go change that oil, and you go, I don't know how to do it, I go, I'm gonna read you the directions. You have a dog that goes, why weren't you doing this before? It was like, I was trying to, you just didn't understand me. So that's basically where we are, right? Please. Yes, good boy. So good, bud. So good. If the dog's really sharp, you can do some other stuff, right? So I'll wait till he finishes. He's a little bit of a slow eater. Come on, buddy. Sit. Good. Down. Yes. Very nice. Bring him over here. Come here. Sit. Uh-oh, no. Sit. Good. I have to feed for that. Good. Keep doing what you're doing because he was defaulting into a down. So this helps him. Good. This helps him to stay into that sit. All right. Good. Try not to drop food like I just did there. All right.
Down.
Good.
Sit.
Yes. Very nice. I also have the leash on, which I haven't used. But if I'm ever going to press this button, I want him to be on the way to doing the right thing. That's what shuts it off. Or completing it, and that's what shuts it off. So this is almost like a game of hot and cold. I'm not relying on this to get the behavior. I'm teaching this. You must teach it before you rely, right?
Come here, buddy. Nice. Please.
Yes, you see right there, he needed a little bit more help. I offered more information by keeping the button on, but not just staying there, staying stagnant. The dog needed more help. So what I did was,
please.
I moved, good, and I brought him on, right? So now we have a dog. Eventually, I can use this for nopes and interruptions, one step at a time. I want this to be fun. I want a dog with this session, we end with a dog going, that was fantastic. I wanna learn more, you know what I mean? Like that, I wanna end with a dog wanting more. So that's a short session, nice and sweet. Yes, I don't wanna drain him. I don't want it to become like, oh my gosh, I get it, what the heck, man? And little by little, we begin to add to the challenge and we begin to test a little bit more. We begin to test where levels go a little higher. Do you feel it? Are you gonna go faster into the behavior? Things like that, we mess around. But it's very, very important that we always have a tool or a language that allows us to be very soft and gentle, but allows us to yell and match the environment around us if our dog needs it. I want you to think about a couple of things. There's different ways you can yell, there's different ways you can whisper. Right? We can be in a library and I can really, really whisper to you. And if you're distracted by something and the person you're bad mouthing is coming up behind you, I can shut up. That person's right behind you. Give you a little nudge. I'll give you. And it's very light because the environment is light. So the way I whisper to you there is one way. I can also whisper to my wife sexually in bed. I assure you, very different ways to whisper. Right? The way that I can yell at you because I'm pissed at you.
Please.
Good, very nice. Or I can yell at you in the middle of a hockey game or a basketball game or your competition. Okay, now go ahead and do this. And odds are I'm gonna yell at you louder when I'm trying to help you in direction than I was when I was yelling at you when I was pissed at you. The remote collar is your voice. Don't only use it to yell. Otherwise, every time I'm coming in and I open my mouth, you go, oh, he's gonna yell at me. I want it to be fun. Hey man, you wanna go do this? I wanna be able to give direction regardless of the type of direction that's needed, right? At the end of the day, dog training is very simple. Is it worth it? We have the opportunity to have a huge impact on helping our dogs determine what is worth it or not. In some situations, that means making things very rewarding. In other situations, it means making something enough of a consequence or a punishment to get a dog to think twice. Right? That's what dog training is. And as our end as a handler, whether we're a dog owner or a dog trainer, the bottom line is dog training should be as soft as you can be, but as firm as you must be. And it's a time and place for both. It's very, very important that we understand that, right? What else am I gonna get into before I kind of end this video? I'm gonna do a Q&A for you guys on Periscope in just a second. Did I address everything that I pretty much wanted to? I think that I did, for the most part. So that's what a first session should look like. If we don't have a dog looking like that, they're not ready for the remote, right? That's pretty much what we're doing here. And it's important that you guys aren't using certain tools as a last resort tool. Teach the tool before you rely on it, okay?